Hello, planet Earth. Welcome back to my YouTube channel. We're at IDK, my BFF Jill, 730. I'm Presnell Young, wishing you warm salutations and congratulations. You've made your way to the Buffington Post. Today, as promised, we are going to stop and take stock of everything we've learned throughout Season 8 so far. We are now technically at issue number 26, which would be Tales of the Vampires, The Thrill. And yeah, join me now as we cover everything we've gone over so far and look to see what exactly is going on this season. So here we go, it's Buffy Season 8, The Halfway Point. Early to rise, early to bed, and in between I cooked and cleaned and went out of my head. Going through life with blinders on, it's tough to see. I had to get up, get out from under and look for me. There's a new girl in town and she's looking good. There's a fresh freckle face in the neighborhood. There's a new girl in town with a brand new style. She was just passing through, but if things work out, she's gone. Alright guys, so it's a big transition coming from a television show to being a comic book. And this is illustrated to us through what is the most powerful force in the Buffyverse. So what do you think the most powerful force in the Buffyverse is? Buffy herself? Is it magic? The powers that be? The senior partners? The old ones? Is it love or humanity? It's time. In Angel After the Fall, Illyria is restored to its true old one, pure demon form. And it is driven so mad by reality that it starts to literally try to consume time, which will be an end to everything. Time is the most powerful force in the Buffyverse. You can have time and not have magic. You can have time and not have humanity. You can have time and not have love, but without time, you can't have any of that. Time is the most powerful force in the Buffyverse. Keep that in mind. Now, what does time really have to do with anything? Okay, so from 2003 to 2007, there was no Buffy the Vampire Slayer as far as the canonical story goes. You had the Buffy the Vampire Slayer comic books that were being produced by Dark Horse, but they weren't canonical. They didn't really give anything new to the story. The first issue of Buffy Season 8 was released in March of 2007, and the one that we just finished, Tales of the Vampires, didn't release until June of 2009, and so clearly time is a real factor. We are going from having 22 episodes within 9 months to now having had 26 issues within the space of 2 years. And I remember this. Hey Hope, hey Meredith, hey Kelly. You remember Pablo? I was at Pablo's house reading Living Doll, which is issue number 25. That's how long ago this was. It took 2 years just to get halfway through. And so time is a great big factor. In Time of Your Life Part 2, Willow and Hearth are talking about love, and Hearth says to Willow, what in this world is more powerful than love? And Willow says, time, only time, okay? And so, Buffy has now become a comic book superhero. Everything is global, she's everywhere, there's magic everywhere, Willow is flying around. They're going to Japan, there's an army of vampire slayers, Dawn's a giant, we're dealing with Dracula. There's a lot of magic, and Buffy is, like I said, a comic book superhero. She is not confined to the realm of television, and what happens is we've got so much magic, and the fandom at this point has turned into a bunch of Angel Season 4 Connors. They're just like Connor. They say, there's too much magic. There's too much magic. Everything's too big. Reel in the magic. Well, what have we been laying the seeds for since the beginning of Season 8? Twilight is going to be the death of magic. You asked for it, fandom. You said too much magic, and Twilight is going to bring about an end to magic. We find out from Sifrillion, the demon who lives, like, outside of time and reality, that the Twilight situation will be this event, the death of magic. But then, like, right after this, we get this Twilight figurehead. Now, we met the Twilight figurehead in No Future for You, but this person, like, confronts Buffy. Okay, and so this is kind of a conflict of ideas. Is Twilight this event, or is it this person? When Buffy and Willow went into Sifrillion's lair, they were together, and Buffy found out that someone was going to betray her in there. And she and Willow were there together, and Buffy asked Willow if she was the one to have betrayed her. Is that why they're in this together, seeing this together? And Willow says no. And so when Buffy goes into the future, she kills Willow. Could this be the destruction of magic? Because Willow does kind of embody magic in the Buffyverse. So let's lay that idea down for a minute and just focus on this Twilight figurehead that we've been introduced to. Okay, so this Twilight character is running things with, like, General Vall in the military, whatever, okay? And so, what happened? He obviously enlisted the help of the military. They're working with Twilight. They've got the same symbol carved into their chests, some of them. The first thing that Twilight does is they send Amy and Warren after Buffy and Willow. But when Buffy and Satsu and Willow got to Sunnydale, they destroyed the whole military base, so Twilight really hasn't accomplished much. Gigi and Rodan were super kilted by Faith and Giles, so Twilight said that that was his plan, to get rid of Gigi and Rodan and to leave Faith and Giles wandering out in the wilderness. In Time of Your Life, the bomb that Amy and Warren sent to the castle, Buffy wasn't even there, and it didn't even kill anybody, so not a great plan. And then when Twilight approaches Buffy in A Beautiful Sunset, he straight up lets Buffy live. He beats the shit out of her and then sends her on her merry way. And he just goes off. He says, I'm letting you live. And the Vampy Cats, well, the Vampy Cats, they were all destroyed. They said that Twilight was sending them to Scotland, but they all got destroyed. And so Twilight right now is not a very good villain. It turns out that Harmony has proven to be more of a threat than this Twilight character. All Harmony had to do was get her picture taken, and that's all it took for Buffy to be completely undercut by vampires. Vampires are the cool new thing, and now slayers are running for their lives. It's a paradigm shift that Twilight didn't have anything to do with. It was one vampire. Okay, what did Twilight tell Buffy? Said that she had changed the world way too quickly, and that the whole world and these girls that she put out there were going to suffer for it. And we've seen some evidence for this. Way back in season 5 of Angel, we saw Dana. She was going around killing people because she wasn't ready to receive this power that Buffy gave to her. Alex, we just covered her in Tales of the Vampires. She didn't have any other slayers around her. She doesn't have a watcher. Buffy gave her this power, and it got her killed. Homegirl, the vampire slayer, the one that Harmony killed, she didn't want anything to do with Buffy because of the way that she felt she was running her whole institution, and she got herself killed. There are no more watchers. There are no, like, Slayer support groups except for Buffy's little squads. And so what Buffy has introduced into the world has killed several of these girls. Not to mention the Slayer that pretended to be Buffy and went down on a suicide mission. Not to mention Renee, these girls who chose to be a part of this fight. These girls are being affected by Buffy's choices and, okay, sure, their own, but they haven't aligned themselves with this fight that Buffy's a part of, and it's still affecting them. And so it turns out Twilight was right. Like, these girls will suffer for what Buffy has done. And yeah, the humans are now chasing slayers away and trying to kill them. So this is really scary. So let's talk about Simone. Okay, so Simone basically is our Magneto. You've got Buffy, and what has she done? Sure, she stole a bunch of money and all this good stuff, but she basically made an X-mansion. She made a system to where she could bring these girls together, train them in how to use their powers, and etc., etc. She did some illegal things to do this, and, you know, Professor X, he pretty much did the same thing. He was controlling people's minds to build all of his bullshit, and he just didn't let them remember any of it. And so, you've got Simone as your Magneto, though. And what is Magneto? Well, Simone, where we just left her, she has said, if the whole world wants to paint me as a threat, then I'm going to be a threat. And what does she do? She says, you're going to go out and protect a world of people who hate and fear you? I'm not about that. That's a Magneto argument. And what else does she do? She annexes an entire island for her and her slayers. Sounds like Genosha to me. And so you have these conflicting ideas, this real, like, Buffy's concerned about the way that Simone is handling being a slayer, but at the same time, Simone is just reacting to what people are putting out there at her. So, yeah, Simone is kind of our Magneto. So, you do have this whole X-Men thing, and it's gonna go way X-Men-y toward the end of the season, but we'll deal with that when it gets there. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about our individual characters and what exactly has been going on with them. Willow has been very distant this entire season, and the thing to remember about Willow is that she likes having secrets. We saw it in season 2 when she was trying to learn a bit about magic behind Giles' back. We saw it in season 3 when she and Xander were having their little secret love affair. We saw it in season 4 when she was hiding Tara away from everybody. We saw it in season 5 when she was keeping Giles a secret. We saw it in season 6 prevalently when she was trying to hide her magic addiction. And we saw it in season 7 a little bit, as far as her not really wanting to open up to Kennedy because she was afraid of herself. Which isn't really hiding anything, but Willow, like I said, enjoys her secrets. And so she has been very much keeping herself separated from Buffy emotionally and physically. She's not around for a good chunk of what's going on, actually, if you really think about it. She has this mysterious relationship with the sexy snake lady, which we still don't know a whole lot about. She's been keeping Kennedy away from Buffy because, as I said earlier, she's afraid of getting Kennedy involved in this whole life and getting her killed the way it did Tara. Willow has been through a lot. She suffered an incredible loss when it came to Tara. She went totally off the deep end. She went to the darkest place she could have gone, and then she went to the lightest place she could have gone. And the interesting thing about Willow is she does kind of separate herself from the group. She really needs something. As she said to Tara in this year's Girl, she needs something that's hers, something that is just hers. And I can relate to that, you know, being the youngest child in one house and the middle child in another house, you want to have something that's yours. You don't want to be compared to Buffy all the time. You don't want to just be something. You want to have something that you can say, this is mine. I have a secret. And so right now, Willow is keeping these secrets, and we don't know exactly what they are or how devastating they're going to be. And even 200 years from now, she's still keeping secrets. And we don't really know how this is all going to unfold. I still don't, having, you know, been up to season 10 now. But just keep in mind that Willow has been separating herself, and we have to assume that it's for a good reason, or we at least have to appreciate that Willow has her reasons, whether or not they're good. Now, we got Xander, and Xander has, like, the worst luck with love. I mean, sure, Buffy's technically got the worst luck with love, but Xander, he, like, falls in love with these women, and they're either demons, or they die, or both. And, yeah, he finally got his wish. He was hooked up with a slayer, and Renee just kind of died. Xander's been doing a lot this season. He hasn't been talking to Willow. Xander and Willow will not have a one-on-one conversation until season 10, and that pisses me off. You can watch my very first video. I was very excited about the fact that they did have an interaction. So, yeah, he has been helping Dawn to kind of grow up a little bit and talk about her feelings and all this good stuff, which is great for Xander and it's great for Dawn. He's been basically keeping Buffy in as high spirits as he possibly can, because Buffy will get to her, but Xander has basically just been doing his Xander thing and being there for us. And there's something really weird going on between the Xander and Buffy relationship this season. I don't know if you've picked up on it, but in the first arc, Xander, he was in Buffy's dream, and Buffy dreamt that she was inviting him into her bed, and then she kissed him. And then when she was in the sleep spell, Amy tempted Xander with, did he want to try and kiss Buffy? And so that didn't really go anywhere because then we jumped into the relationship between Xander and Renee. But then when we got to after these messages, we'll be right back, Buffy was sleeping in Xander's bed. So there's something weird going on with the Buffy Xander relationship here, and we'll see how that folds out as the season progresses. So looking at Dawn and her growing pains, I went over Dawn pretty much in Living Doll, and I talked about everything that she's kind of going through. And basically, Dawn, by this point, is like in it as herself. She's finally comfortable with herself. She's found out how she's going to fit into the comic books. She's not going to be some great big mystical thing. She's just going to be Buffy's sister. And this is actually a really great way to use Dawn. They introduced her through the first half because there was so much going on that Dawn couldn't be directly tied to, that they gave her kind of her own little magical subplot. And it worked pretty well, but now Dawn as a human is going to be much more important for the story. And so basically, Dawn is growing up on us. She's had sex, she's been a giant, she's been a centaur, and now she's just back to being our little sister. And so stay tuned. Some really interesting things are going to be going on with Dawn throughout the rest of the season and really throughout the rest of the series. Giles and Faith. Where exactly do Giles and Faith fit into this new regime? They don't. They have separated themselves from Buffy and her institution. The Watchers Council no longer exists. It got all blowed up by Caleb, and Giles is told us that he pretty much is the Watchers Council. But Buffy and Giles were going through some friction before the end of the series. That whole ordeal with Spike and Robin and all that good stuff, it really drove a wedge between Buffy and Giles, one that's not going to be easily remedied. And then, you have Faith. Buffy's the general of the Slayer army. Everybody looks at Buffy like she's in charge still. And where Faith really didn't fit in anywhere before this army of Slayers, where does she really fit now? Like I said, I had this theory that when Faith dies, it'll be a great big shakeup for the Slayer power, but that's yet to be really, that's just my personal theory. But yeah, Faith and Giles don't really belong anywhere in Buffy's fight. And maybe they do, but they don't feel like they do, and they really don't feel welcome. And so they've been off doing their own thing, and it'll be really interesting to see where those characters go from here. Shout out for Andrew. Andrew has been making waves. He's, full-blown Scooby, half a Watcher, and he's just been getting more and more into the mix of things as we've been moving through season 8. And so there'll be some more interesting stuff for Andrew to do later on. And by season 10, he'll be a full-fledged Scoob. And Buffy. Buffy. Buffy has just got this whole new life. She's a general. She's in charge of all of these people. She's more responsible for the world's safety than ever. And she's also responsible for the deaths of these girls. Like I said, she's not got her mother. Giles is completely absent. Her father, God knows what the fuck is going on with him, wherever he is. Is he in LA? Is he still in Spain? Who knows? It's crazy. She is trying to figure out what to do with all of this power, and everybody keeps trying to tell her how to use her power and how not to use her power, and then these Japanese vampires come along and try to take away everything that she put into the world. And maybe in hindsight that would have been okay. And she's fighting this Twilight thing that she doesn't understand and looks pretty inevitable. And she tried on her lesbian pants, and she'd gotten this weird like work relationship, and she's just all over the place. And that's kind of the thing. Like, the property, the comic book, is all over the place because Buffy is all over the place. She doesn't know what to think because we don't know what to think. It's been 2 years and we're still only halfway through the season. Things are only gonna get crazier from here. She went to the future. She found out that this whole thing that she created, is not even here anymore. It doesn't exist. She may as well have just not done it, as far as she's concerned. She found Willow in the future, and she killed her. You know, this Buffy's mind is all the fuck over the place right now, and it's gonna get crazier, like I said. But yeah, just think about all of these things. Think about how Twilight keeps coming after us, but what is it really accomplishing? Think about, what is Willow trying to do over here? Are Buffy and Xander ever gonna, like, get to it? And how is Buffy going to fare in this comic book world? How will Buffy adjust to being a comic book superhero going forward? And, you know, you can complain all you want about there being too much magic and giants and goddesses and all, like, being all over the globe. You can complain all you want about it, but Twilight's coming and it's going to be an end to magic, so be careful what you wish for. And so, you know, yeah, just watch out for time, because it'll bite you in the ass. Or, you know, stab you in the chest with the scythe. Alright, that's pretty much all for today's Buffyverse discussion on where we are in Season 8 right now, and what to kind of keep your ears open for and eyes open for as we move forward. I'm Preston L. Young. I hope you're having a great 2015 so far. You can come right back here to the Buffington Post anytime. I've got Buffyverse discussions, discussions on the other Slayers, Buffy comic reviews, Angel and Faith comic reviews, my weekly Game of Thrones episode reviews, and some other stuff. I hope you're having a great day. You can like, dislike, comment, share, subscribe, and as always, question. If you have a question for me, leave it down below, and if I like it enough, I'll respond to you. So if you do leave a question for me, just tweet at me, at ThePWitty. Let me know what your YouTube subscriber name is, and also send me a picture of yourself so I can include you in a video if I decide to include your question in a video. Once I get enough questions and enough pictures from all of you guys, I'm going to do a little thank you video. I'm going to use the Wonder Years theme so I can say, thank you. I get by with help from you, my friends. All right, so that's all for today. Have a great day. We'll see you next time.